And my today's presentation is on post-polio deformity part 2, in which I will discuss the reconstructive surgery and development of the deformities in lower limb. I have the expert with me, Professor Imtiaz Hashmi, Zameer Sumro from Ladkana, and Farid Zibri from Islamabad. We have already discussed the principles of the poliomyelitis development and the treatment. We have covered pathological processes, pathoanatomy, clinical assessment, and principle of reconstructive surgery, including tendon and muscle transfers. Today, the regional deformities, management precision, and the case discussion, particularly in lower limb. In decision making, there are multiple factors. Important of these factors are the age of the patient, functional assessment of the limb and spine, socio-economic background to have the continuous physiotherapy and the support, and the radiological examination for the assessment of the deformities. Then we have also discussed the functional assessment. Before embarking to surgery, we must do the muscle charting, power grading of the muscles, extent of the contractures and deformities, ambulatory status and the posture of the patient, and limb length discrepancy, which you can see in part 1 lecture, which we have two weeks back. Then we have also discussed in the cerebral palsy and in the poliomyelitis, the Trendelenburg test, extent of contracture and deformities to know with the Trendelenburg test, Thomas test, Oberjahn test, ankle and foot deformity assessment, and the spinal curvatures and the pelvic curvatures. You can see on the YouTube and the slide share these lectures which we held in the last year, and this in the poliomyelitis deformity paralysis principles. We have also discussed the ambulatory status of patient, multiple gates, their analysis, different type of the gates, and the handy gate, particularly calcaneus gate, foot drop, and the short limb gate. We have already covered in the cerebral palsy analysis, that is the gait disorder lecture, which we have around 2 months back. There are multiple prognostic factors which we must know before embarking to surgery. They are the severity of initial paralysis, diffuseness of the regional distribution, then the patient's expectation and parents' expectation, and the psychosocial support and the resource availability. It is said in general that the more extensive the paralysis and first few days of the illness, the more severe ultimate disability will bear, and then the correction and the reconstruction of the surgery depends on these factors. We have already discussed on the reconstructive surgery options, which include fasciotomies, capsulotomies, tendon transfer, muscle transposition, stabilization of joint with maybe flail, with the tenodesis, and the reconstructive surgery. Different options we already have discussed in general, and the correction of deformity and the stabilization of the joints by osteotomy and arthrodesis, general principles we have discussed. In detail we will discuss today. And the limb length procedures with Elizarov technique with the limb length and concomitant the contracture release. We have also discussed few aspects of the joint replacement in polio surgery and the correction of the obliquity of the spine and the pelvis in general. Today I will discuss the reconstructive surgery, the objective of reconstructive surgery, and the development of deformity in poliomyelitis in lower limb mostly is the patient to return home with ease and have a good stability. And patient should be accepted as an integrated part of the community as a normal social persons. So regarding hip deformity, important aspect is the muscle imbalance. If there is a muscle imbalance, there is contracture. If there is a contracture of flexion and abduction of the muscle by iliotibial bend with the paralysis of gluteus medius and minimus, it will produce an abductor lunge. And if it is unilateral, it will produce a Trendelenburg sign. And the later, when there is a contracture here, it produces a pelvic obliquity, and this subsequently cause the subluxation on other side of the hip joint. And we will discuss that is the paralytic dislocation and subluxation because of the muscle imbalance. The other factor is the positional factor. When the child during the acute paralysis and the columnist phase lie, are they sleep, are they stay, with the frog leg position, it produces a postural contracture which may extend from the hip joint to the knee joint, and as you meet completely they get externally rotated, and how this external rotation occur I will discuss in other slides. And then there is a secondary soft tissue contracture, particularly iliotibial band, tensor fasciae latae and iliotibial band, and it produces a permanent deformity at the hip joint which we call flexion abduction hip contracture and the knee flexion deformity. So iliotibial band is a very important factor in the development of contractures around the hip joint, around the knee joint, and even at the ankle joint. Now in next slides I will discuss how do this iliotibial band produce the contractures. So iliotibial band usually lies anterolaterally around the hip joint or to the knee joints and to the Gladys tubercle. So it produces a flexion abduction external rotation contracture of the hip joint, and subsequently in chronic phase it also produces a contracture at the knee joint by virtue of its placement on the lateral and anterior surfaces over the hip and the knee joints. And because of the further comfort position in the frog leg position, the children develop external rotation around the hip abductors and as well as around the knee joint and the tibia. So iliotibial band contractures, besides producing a flexion contracture at the hip joint, at the knee joint, it also produces a genu-valgum deformity at the knee joint, and along with the flexion contracture around the tibia at the knee joint. So iliotibial band also produces an external tibial traction because of its pull on the tibia as it lies on anterolateral surface over the Gladys tubercle. With or without knee subluxation, this knee subluxation occurs in the chronic phase, and when the paralysis of the quadriceps is there, hamstring are strong, then it produces a subluxation at the knee joint. Initially it is smaller subluxation, and gradually its effect, particularly because of the posture, it also produces a problem at the ankle joint, which we will discuss in it. Because of the strong biceps muscle, weak quadriceps muscle, strong hamstrings, and the iliotibial band contracture, it produces external torsion the tibia, which get exaggerated, and in extreme position it produces the subluxation, and this subluxation particularly occur because of the strong biceps. Then because of the posture, it produces two type of deformity as per the postural placement. One is the cavus deformity at the foot joint, other is the equinovarus deformity at the foot joint. It also produced by the ill-fitted orthosis. Because of ill-fitted orthosis, there is a flaility, and that compensate the external tibial torsion, which is caused by the tight iliotibial tract. So this deformity, again because of the tight iliotibial tract, produced a deformity which is called cavovarus or the equinovarus deformity, ankle joint. Then the pelvic obliquity. It is also produced because of the pelvic oblique contracture of the abduction at the hip joint and the flexion contracture at the hip joint. When the patient lies, he is sleeping, there is a shortening which is apparent. When he stands, then there to compensate the both ankles at the, because of this shortness, he places both feet on the floor, and thus in the chronic phase it produces a pelvic obliquity. And we have already discussed, because of this pelvic obliquity contracture on the one side, on other side there is a gradual subluxation, and then chronic phases then it produces a dislocation on the other side. It is because of the shortness and the compensation of this shortness on standing phase, and when the long lasting standing phase, because of shortness there is a pelvic obliquity. So this pelvic obliquity again is produced by the abductors flexor and the particularly iliotibial band. Then there is an iliotibial band contracture, it produces, again there is a detail how do it produce a pelvic obliquity on the standing and the chronic. This one of the my patient again shows a contracture on the abduction, flexion contracture on this side, and gradual subluxation on the other side. So it's, when it is persistent and the chronic, it also produces a scoliosis deformity because of the pelvic obliquity. It is not only the pelvic obliquity would produce the scoliosis, but it may also produce when there is a bilateral flexion contracture, flexion abduction contracture, it produces an increased lumbar ladder. You have seen these patients with the pelvic obliquity with flexion contractures and significant flexion contracture. To compensate this flexion contracture, the patients develop increased lumbar lordosis. So we can say the single muscle, tensor fasciae latae, iliotibial tract, can produce multiple deformity along with the posture and the strong biceps and strong hamstrings. It produces a deformity at hip joint. It produces a deformity at knee joint and the postural contractures. It produces a pelvic obliquity, scoliosis, lumbar lordosis. It can produce pes varus deformity, pes valgus because of the posture and ill-fitted braces. So hip contracture, hip abduction contracture with external rotation, paralytic dislocation, knee flexion contracture, knee subluxation, external rotation, tibial torsion. This is all produced because of the tight iliotibial tract, because of the postural maintenance and the strong hamstring, particularly biceps. So next, we will start how these contractures can be released and the deformity can be reduced and the patient may be made a normal walking human being with or without braces. So there is indication for the surgery. If flexion hip contracture is over 30 degree, then there is a problem. Below 30 degree, just compensation of the posture, they reduce the contracture and walk. But when the contracture is over 16 degree, then there is an indication for surgery. But there is a contraindication always, because when the one arm or both arm are weakness and person is not able to use crutches, then there is a contraindication. Don't make this patient more troublesome to wheelchair bound instead of the making a normal human being. So again, here shall be the decision that when we should operate for these release of contracture below 2 years, over the 2 years age, and also the severity of the contracture. These two important factors produce certain decision making factor. In young children, surgery is different. There's less than 3 or 4 years. Over 4 years or in the teenage, the surgery is different. The initial stages we do release of the contracture, release of the tight tensor fascia latae and iliotibial bend. When the child is more than teenage, then we also divide the ligaments, particularly as in capsulotomy, posterior capsulotomy, we also do the lengthening of the tendons. So here, when there is a hip contractures, we do either suture slide of the fasciotomy or a Campbell's release. This Campbell's release I will discuss in detail, where we release the tensor fascia latae, gluteus maximus from their origin, and to correct the fistulation deformity, abduction deformity of the hip joint. Then also we do the ober yawn, another procedure in which ober yawn release, we do the sartorius release, we do release of tensor fascia latae, and deep, when there is a significant contractures, we also do the rectus femoris, gluteus medius, minimus, and the iliopsoas tendon, but don't do the capsulotomy of the hip joint. So it means when there is a severe contracture, and I will show one of the patient in the last slides, that how do we release the iliopsoas and how do it is effective. But in simple contractures, in minor or moderate contracture, we don't release the iliopsoas, but we restrict ourselves to the sartorius release, to the tensor fascia latae and the gluteus medius origin. But sometimes there is a knee contracture as well in association with the hip contractures. Then we use the yawns release or resection of the thickened anterolateral iliotibial bend to correct the knee deformity as well. But caution should be here, we should not do damage to the popliteal arteries, peroneal nerves, which is abutting to the biceps tendon, and we should while dissecting the biceps muscle. Next, this shows the example of the yawns release, where only we do the fasciotomy and release of the abductors. And if we do the severe contractures, we do the Campbell slide. In the Campbell slide, we release the tensor fascia latae, we release the gluteus from iliac crest and bring it down. At the same time, if there is a redundant part of the bone, iliac crest, we release iliac crest, but don't suture these over there so that it releases the contractures by the Campbell slide. But if there is severe, then we also release the rectus femoris and the iliopsoas tendon when there is a significant contracture. And we have already discussed how to know there is a iliopsoas contracture of other side on the same side. When there we do the Thomas test, if other side of the hip joint moves in the flexion, it means there is a flexion contracture of the iliopsoas. And this is one of the case which shows there was a flexion abduction contracture at the hip joint. There was a contracture at the knee joint, and with the release of the yawns and the Campbell slide, there is a significantly correction of the contracture in the on the this side. Then paralysis of the gluteus maximus, and we have shown you these three slides in the gait disorder lecture. There's when there is a gluteus maximus paralysis, there is a full lurch, that is child is backward lurch doing to compensate the paralysis of the glutei. When there is unilateral, there is a Trendelenburg sign, you can see easily. So these two are because of the gluteal maximus and gluteus medius paralysis with the Trendelenburg gait and the backward lurch. The operation for these mostly is the transfer of the iliopsoas tendon to compensate the gluteus medius and maximum weakness, which we transfers to the director trochanter, and also sometimes the external obliquus muscle to be transferred to the gluteus. That's why I always says when you are checking for the limb muscle power, you must also check for the abdominal muscle power. Maybe you need a transfer of external oblique for the compensation of the Trendelenburg gait. So these are the showing the what should be done in different ages. When the age is less than 2 years, in early stage, you have to balance, dynamic balance to the hip joint to prevent the pelvic ability and the subluxation. If early age, simple adductor tenotomy with and without open reduction you can do to release the contracture, adduction contracture, because when there is adduction contracture, it further leads to the subluxation. But in the later stage, you need a balancing of power. When the balancing of power needed, you have to transfer iliopsoas tendon, but that is the age over 4 and 5 years, not early age. But if there is a cosa velga over 150 degrees, you have to correct this cosa vera and bring the neck shaft angle to 110 degree and then transfer the iliopsoas tendon. But when the age is over 2 years, mean 3, 4, 5 years, you need to transfer the postpone and the iliopsoas tendon, and the stability of hip is periodically monitored with and without adductor tenotomy. If you find there is a cosa velga over 160 degree, you have, and there is substantial luxation of the hip joint in less than 6 years, proximal femur varus dorotation osteotomy has to be done. It means the femoral neck shaft angle has to be brought up to the 105 degree. And in older children over 6 years, the same derotation varus osteotomy has to done to reduce the femoral neck shaft angle less than 125 degrees. So here is the treatment, how to transfer the iliopsoas tendon to the greater trochanter, which we called a Sherard's transfer of the iliopsoas tendon. We make a hole in the plate of the ilium, detach the iliopsoas tendon from the lesser trochanter, and pass this iliopsoas muscle and the tendon through this hole in the ilium to bring forward laterally over the greater trochanter, and then with the 2 or 3 screw, we'll transfer this iliopsoas from this hole of the ilium. This is called Sherard's procedure. But there is some modification, Wiesinger modification, in which iliopsoas is not to be passed through the ilium hole, but it is rerouted through a lateral side and through the sciatic notch, and then transferred to the greater trochanter, and then fixed with the 2 screws. So this is called Sherard's and Wiesinger iliopsoas transferred to the greater trochanter to compensate particularly for gluteal medius and gluteal maximus weakness. And this is the example of varus derotation intertrochanteric osteotomy, which are Lard and the Roberts procedure, very easy. Over the lesser trochanter, we have to do a more resect 1 centimeter bone on the medial side, and then the fixation with the trochanteric plate or DHS of 150 or less than 150 degree. Then in type of the flail hip joint, when there is a muscle power is significantly paralyzed, there is no muscle power particularly in the abductors, in the flexors, we do the hip arthrodesis. And common procedures you very well know with the cobra plate, which is called the compression displacement osteotomy, and do the cobra plate fixation, and there is a special position for this, and sometimes we do with the DHS and the intra-articular arthrodesis with the screw system. And extra-articular arthrodesis is usually done in the infective processes in the hip joint, not in the poliomyelitis. And the position of the hip joint is very important. It's critical to have a neutral abduction or weight-bearing position. It means 25 degree abduction, not over there. And the flexion or external rotation of the 30 degree, not over 30 degrees. This is the position of ease with 15 degree or 25 degree flexion, neutral abduction and external rotation of 30 degree. And to avoid the abduction and interrotation, because if you do keep the significant abduction and interrotation, the posture of the children will be not proper. And this position is particularly designed to minimize the excessive lumbar spine motion and opposite knee motion. Now the knee deformities, and we already discussed, mostly these deformities are produced because of posture, because of weakness of the quadriceps, strong iliotibial drain and iliotibial drain contractures. And the quadriceps femoral paresis, mostly it produces a handy gait initially, but in the chronic phases when there is a decompensation and the bony abnormalities and the give way of the posterior ligaments and the biceps muscles is strong, they produce this type of recurvatum gait. We have seen 3 weeks back this significant contractures and the recurvatum gait. Particularly because of weak quadriceps, knee is stabilized initially with the handy gait, and later there is a mild genu valgum deformity because of strong biceps and hamstring muscles. And knee is stabilized particularly by the locking of the hyperextension of the knee joint. And the treatment in early stage is bracing. If you do the bracing in this stage, this give a good results. But in particularly in the severe recurvatum, on the less there is a compensation and you need such and surgical procedures. The surgical procedures in the quadriceps femoris paralysis, particularly the gross genu valgum deformity, is the muscle transfers, which is usually we do the biceps and semitendinosus transfer is on the patella. And commonly, usually this procedure give good results. But in the later, we do the sartorius, we can do the sartorius transfer, we can do tensor fasciae latae transfer, we can do the adductor longus. But popular is the biceps and semitendinosus transfer in combination. But when there is a significant structural deformity, we do the posterior wedge, closing wedge osteotomy, because in the chronic stage, it is not only the recurvatum deformity, but there is a procurvatum deformity of the knee joint, of the bone, like this. And then we do the osteotomy to get the good coverage for the compensation for the recurvatum. And sometimes we do the triple tenodesis for the genu valgus deformity. Multiple procedures are there. There is a dome osteotomy, open wedge osteotomy, and Ayurvedic techniques. Here shows the triple tenodesis of the genu recurvatum deformity, where we cut the medial head of the gastrocnemius and the tendons of the gastrocnemius. Further, I will discuss how we do the tenodesis, and then the capsular cutting, and then advancement of the capsule to compensate for, to bring the flexion, particularly flexion attitude of the hip joint to compensate the, we do the contracture particularly in strengthening the posterior capsule. And this gluteus medius, we will do a transfer of the the semitendinosus and the gracilis muscle. We pass through a tibial hole, then the femoral hole, and the reattach with the medial head of gastrocnemius to produce a reconstruction of the chacrine ligament posteriorly. But in long term, they may again may fall, but long termly patient used a brace to continue this chacrine ligament. When there is a flexion decontracture of significance, then we do anterior wedge osteotomy, closing wedge osteotomy for the knee joint. And particularly in the flexion decontractures, there are three areas. If the contracture is 15 to 20 degree, we do posterior hamstring lengthening and the capsulotomy. But when the contracture is more than 20 degree to 70 degree, we do supracondylar extension osteotomy like that. Whenever you do supracondylar extension osteotomy, it means you are giving way or the less degree of flexion attitude of the hip joint. But when the contracture is more than 70 degree, you need to cut the iliotibial bend, you need to release the hamstring tendon, and with the combined posterior capsulotomy, but no supracondylar osteotomy. And we will show the case in the last discussion, then how do it produce a good results? The post-operative care usually place this with the tube interaction in the knee joint and the long-term use of the braces for the, so that it, this contracture do not redevelop again. Then if there is a flail knee, the flail knee is very unstable because of the multiple flexor and extensor paralysis, then we need a long leg braces. If patient is not able to do long leg braces, and in very rare cases, we do knee arthrodesis. And you know the procedure how to do the knee arthrodesis. The last part of this lecture is the foot and ankle deformity. There are multiple varieties of the contracture of the foot and deformities of the foot, which ranges from up to the 7 type. And there develops the claw toes to telipsic cunnilinus to calcaneus deformities, was worst treat. And how do these deformity as produced? There is a classification of the Peabody, in which the extensor inverters of limited insufficiency, grass limitation of extensor inverter insufficiency, inverters insufficient, and traps as pseudo inversions in deficiencies. And I will discuss in the few slides that how do this limited extensor inverter insufficiency produce the contractures. So here is the example of the inverter extensor insufficiency. When there is a limited extensor inverter insufficiency, there is a tibialis anterior muscle paralysis, which produce slowly a progressive deformity. And this deformity with the posture further develops equinus, because tibialis anterior weak, extensor dorsiflexors are weak. So patient goes in, the foot goes in the equinus position. But when there is a lateral imbalance, it produces cavus because of the short muscle contractures, and varied degree of the plano-valgus can also be produced. So treatment in this particular case is the redistribution of muscle power by transferring the extensor hallucis longus tendon to compensate the anterior tibial paralysis. And this extensor hallucis in the limited extension in the mild contractures is transferred to the first metatarsal base. And then there is a plantar fasciotomy to compensate the cavus deformity. So if there is a moderate, there is then typing of the deformity, that is the Peabody's classification, inverter extensor insufficiency type A. When there is a grass extensor inverter insufficiency, there is a paralysis of the toe extensor along with the tibialis anterior, it produces again a severe equinus deformity. And then if there is a lateral imbalance, it produces equino-valgus deformity. Here we can transfer the peroneus longus to the dorsum in the lateral cuneiform, first cuneiform bone. Also along with the telonavicular arthrodesis we can do in the combined if deformity is fixed. In the fixed deformity, we do the arthrodesis, and the mobile deformity, we produce transfer of the peroneus longus to first cuneiform. But when there is a type 2 paralysis or B paralysis of both tibialis anterior and tibialis posterior, it means inverters and the toe extensor as well. Inverter and extensors of the dorsiflexion are significantly disturbed, then we transfer both peronei to dorsum of the foot. And this shows how do the severe insufficiency of extensors produce a deformity of cavus and the equinus deformity. But when there is an inverter insufficiency, the lateral imbalance is weak and there is a strong muscles on the medial side, it usually produces a varus foot. When the tendon achilles is strong, it means it also produces a equino-varus deformity. When deformity is slight or mild deformity, we transfer extensor hallucis longus to base of fifth metatarsal. In the other side, we were transferring on the first metatarsal. Here, we will transfer on the fifth metatarsal so that we can compensate the lateral imbalance. But if there is a severe deformity, then tibialis anterior has to be transferred on the cuboid, means laterally, and extensor hallucis longus to the fifth metatarsal to compensate the lateral insufficiency or inverter's insufficiency. Then there is a telipes equinus, and already discussed the how we get the telipes equinus deformity because of the plantar flexor are stronger than the dorsiflexor. So tight tendon achilles produce the equinus deformity. If it is associated with the lateral imbalance, then it produces equino-varus deformity. But in some time, there is an equino-valgus, which is a posterior deformity produced. So when there is a complete telipes equinus, we treat in early stage why we know intervention, are the conservative methods, that is the serial casting, arthrosis and the shoe wear. But then there is a severe contractures, we do the soft tissue procedure to release in the cavus particularly, and the bony procedures by the either by the Combe's posterior bone plaque or the very popular Lambert-Eady procedure or the plantar arthrodesis. So I will explain the how the posterior bone plaque is created. There is not arthrodesis of the ankle joint, but a bone plaque is created on the top and the superior surface of the calcaneum, so that there is no further flexion of the or equinus of the foot, and this posterior bone plaque halts. Then here is the example how to create a trough and then bone graft here, and the placement of the graft like this, so that foot should not go in the equinus position, but it is not the ankylosis. But there is a complication for this, that it can produce a talus flattening, it may produce an ankylosis. Then there is a Lambert-Eady procedure. In Lambert-Eady procedure, we do talonavicular and calcaneocuboid fusion. By resecting a bone, inferior part of the talus is to be resected, and this portion or dorsal portion, remaining portion of talus is denuded of the soft tissues, and we make a trough in the navicular bone as you see here, and the trough produced in this, we insert and realign the foot in the neutral position, normal position. This means there is Lambert-Eady procedure by creating a wedge in the navicular trough and the arthrodesis of the talocalcaneocuboid joint. This is called Lambert-Eady procedure with the simple equinus deformity. But when there is a talipes equinovarus deformity, we may transfer the muscles or tendons, and we also do the Lambert-Eady procedure along with the lateral wedge resection here. When there is a clawing of the cavus deformity, when toe extensors there is when there is a talipes equinovarus deformity in young children, 4 to 8 years, initially we give the double bar press, stretching of the plantar fascia and the posterior ankle contracture released by wedge casting. But in the later stage operative procedures, we do the tendoacles lengthening, which is tight, posterior capsulotomy, and anterior transfer of tibialis posterior or split transfer of tibialis anterior to the lateral part and to the insertion of peroneus brevis tendon. And the anterior surface of medial half of the tendoacles sometimes we do. My Professor Kazi and Professor Suleiman used to do this scalpel procedure particularly in CP. But child has been more than 8 years, we do a standular release to compensate for or release the cavus deformity of foot and the triple arthrodesis. And when there is muscle power weakness as well, we also transfer tibialis posterior to the dorsum. And when there is a flexion contracture or the toe contractures, flexion contractures, we also do the modified Jones procedure. When tibialis posterior is weak, we transfer tibialis anterior laterally to the midline. So if there is example of the triple arthrodesis, we denude the cartilage here and cartilage on the lateral, but depends, this is the triple arthrodesis where the subtalar joint, mid-tarsal joints are denuded with an incision over the lateral surface on the sinus tarsi. We release all three joints and denude from the cartilage and soft tissue, get the realign. But when there is a significant varus, we also take the lateral wedge from there, or sometime open wedge osteotomy at the mid-tarsal joint to bring the normal alignment of the foot. Here is the example of the split transfer of tibialis anterior and tibialis posterior transfer to the dorsum. In the split transfer, we divide the in the two parts the tibialis anterior, and half of this is shifted to the lateral cuneiform or the cuboid bone and reattach, while in the posterior tibial, we reroute, release the posterior tibial from the insertion and reroute from the fascia to the dorsum in the middle part of. The tibialis posterior is transferred, we can transfer the tibialis anterior, but there is a fixed deformity, we can do the triple arthrodesis. Here is the talipes equinovalgus deformity, equinus and the valgus deformity. And this is mostly caused by the tibialis anterior. Tibialis posterior are weak and peroni and brevis are the strong. And there is a strong triceps suri which are contracted, so it produces a kind of valgus deformity. The treatment in equinovalgus deformity is in mature patient in early stage is the bracing. and the repeated stretching and of casting. But in the later stages, we do the tendo-Achilles landing, transfer, anterior transfer of the peroneals and the Grice-Green arthrodesis subtalar, and I will show you the example of these, how we do. In skeletal mature patient, we do the tendo-Achilles lengthening to compensate for the equinus, then triple arthrodesis followed by anterior transfer of the peronei, because here is the strong peronei and the weak, so we transfer the peronei to the and the modified Jones procedure. I show the examples how to do the, for the bony compensation. We do the Delvin even procedures by open wedge osteotomy of the calcaneocuboid joint and Grice grind subtalar fusion. And this is one of my example of my patient, which I have done the subtalar fusion to bring the normal architecture or the normal position of the bone by subtalar mini fusion. Then there is a calcaneo varus deformity. There is calcaneus varus deformity, forefoot is varus and pronated, and significant calcaneus or significant cavus deformity here. It is the imbalance of the entering muscles and unopposed short toe flexors and other intrinsic muscle. Here the treatment is the Stendler's fasciotomy from the calcaneum, and the peroneus longus is transferred to the base of the second metatarsal, it means the center of the bone, because of this compensation of intrinsic failure. The extensor hallucis longus also transferred to the neck of the first metatarsal to compensate to lift the forefoot up. Then there is a telipes calcaneus deformity, very difficult deformity to correct. It is the significant, all stands on the tendo-Achilles, but tendo-Achilles is very strong tendon to lift the bone and to make the propel the patient and the normal human being. So here, because of the weakness of the tendo-Achilles or the triceps suri, it is very difficult to treat. The treatment is plantar fasciotomy when there is a cavus association to release the intrinsic muscles, then the posterior transfer of tibialis anterior, which is called the P body transfer from the tibialis anterior, which is strong here, we through the fascia or the intraosseous membrane, we transfer to the calcaneum. But deformity is when severe, multiple muscles or tendons are transferred to the calcaneum. When extensor hallucis longus, extensor digital longer strength is good, we transfer both tibialis anterior and peroneals over the calcaneum. If adical muscle are not available, then we do the tenodesis, Westin's tenodesis, and I will show the example of Westin tenodesis, how it is done. So here is the example of Westin tenodesis. We cut the tendo-Achilles from the belly and then produce a tenodesis through the fibula and to bring the normal position of the foot. But if necessary, we can transfer the tibialis anterior passing through the intraosseous membranes to the stump of the tendo-Achilles to give the dynamic type of the equinus while walking. This was the deformity for calcaneus by the tenodesis. But if there is a flail foot, we do Payne-Taylor arthrodesis. And Payne-Taylor arthrodesis, we do the triple arthrodesis as well as the ankle arthrodesis, which we call the Payne-Taylor arthrodesis. Now, the last part of the lecture is the clawing of the toe and the cavovascular deformity. The clawing of the toe is mostly produced by hyperextension of metatarsal phalangeal joint and flexion at the interphalangeal joint. If it is long-lasting, they produce ulcers at the bunions and the ulcer at the tiptoes. Cause is mostly long extensors weakness, and long toe extensors substitutes the dorsiflexion. When there is a weakness of dorsiflexion, long extensors pull the toes upward and produce a clato deformity. And for the lateral clato deformity, we commonly do division of extensor tendon by Z-plasty, dorsal capsulotomy, and the fusion of interphalangeal joint. But the very popular procedure is the girdle stone Taylor tendon transfer, where we give the dorsolateral incision, divide the flexor from here, and then reattach this flexor to the extensor expansion so that this flexor act as an extensor at the metatarsophalangeal joint. Here is the detail of the example, how do we get the flexor tendon and then reattach to the lateral expansion of the dorsal so that it acts is an extensor for the metatarsophalangeal joint, and sometimes we fuse the interphalangeal joint as well. The another procedure for the big toe particularly, it is the Dixon and Avalle procedure. Here, the extensor hallucis tendon is divided proximally and then it is reattached to the neck of the first metatarsal and the phylloxera hallucis longus, so that again it helps compensate for the plateau, and then there is arthrodesis, a distal stump of the extensor hallucis is reattached to the soft tissues, or sometimes people do the arthrodesis of the interphalangeal joint. Then modifies Jones procedure we commonly do for big toe. Here we release the tendon, extensor hallucis longus, and then fix this extensor hallucis tendon to the first metatarsal, and the distal portion of this portion is reattached to the capsule and the interphalangeal joint, and sometimes we do arthrodesis of interphalangeal. So this compensate for the treatment for the big toe cline and the all lateral toes cline. Then there is a cavus in the calf foot deformity, and the primary deformity is forefoot equinus, resulting in the clineness of the toe because of overpull of the extensors, and mild clining disappears if the mild cavus short duration is corrected. But in the severe deformity, we need simple procedures. If severe large callosities are produced in ulcerations, clying may lead to a dorsal dislocation of metatarsal phalangeal joint. In severe cases, it may produce a contracture on the plantar surfaces. The mild deformity, we do the conservative medicine. But in the severe deformity, we do the peroneus longer tendon and imbricate the peroneus brevis with the stump of the peroneus longus, and considering that deformity is due to the imbalance of PBLS anterior and peroneal artery. If we consider that clawing is caused by the disturbance of function of intrinsic muscle of foot, mild cavus and the clawing, we do the arthrodesis of interphalangeal joint as well. So here is the example of treatments. In the young children and moderate deformity, we do the Staedtler's fasciotomy. We cut all the muscles attached with the posterior at the tibial tuberosity. And then in older children, we do the Dyer Skelkinel osteotomy, which I have already shown to you. And sometime with compensation or correction of the cavus deformity, we do the Japa's osteotomy. And Japa's osteotomy particularly, this is one of the example of the cavus deformity in the claw, but the anterior cold wedge osteotomy from the mid-tarsal joint, remove the wedge of the bone and correct the deformities. It will compensate also to correct the clawing toes as well. And indication for this is the cavus without or calcaneal gross muscle imbalance. Here is the example of the Japa's correction. And then particularly, this is little bit painful procedure, and I have done many, because this will not create the shortness of foot as compared to the other mid-tarsal and the triple arthrodesis. Here V is lying over the mid-tarsal joint, two limbs of the V, and we don't resect the part of the bone, but do the V osteotomy apex towards posteriorly, and then the correct the foot by pulling and pressing down and correcting the cavus deformity. Very popular osteotomy in the cavus deformities. Then there is a hips procedure, and the hips procedure, flexor hallucis tendon is divided, extensor digital longus is divided, and proximal end is inserted third cuneiform. All these tendon is inserted third cuneiform, and the extensor hallucis tendon is divided and fixed to the first head of the first metacarpal. So all the extensor tendons fixed at the third metatarsus here, cuneiform in the laterally, and the extensor hallucis longus to the neck of the first metatarsus to compensate the cavus and the equinus and the clator deformities. Then there's some very rare deformity is called the Bunion. Bunion is the metatarsophalangeal joint, and then there is a bunion with the painful flexion of the toe. We transfer the peroneus longal and the midline transfer of the tibialis anterior to third cuneiform. When it is very painful and the fixed deformity, we do the Lepidus technique of deformity correction of the tibialis anterior transfer to the flexors. Dorsal bunion, other technique is the Humart technique. Then there is arthritis and subluxation of the joint. We fuse the subluxation and extensor is fixed to the first metatarsal head. Now the case presentation. When you take a case in the lung case, in the examination, you write history in this way. And I usually recommend to history to be written, and the weaknesses you find, the deformity you find, and the demand of the patient and the decision making, like this example. So this is very popular chart when I used to teach in the poliomyelitis. This chart shows the history of the patient on the top, and then the area which is involved, the hip is involved, knee, ankle, then the discrepancy of lindel. Then you write the diagnosis and the patient's demand and the decision and the deformity. What is the deformity? What are the deficit? What are the substitute available? And what you can do about this procedure? So this chart is very easy to memorize and very easy to give the description and the treatment procedure and the decision making. For example, that patient which were narrated in, on the one page, if you find it will be very difficult, what are the deficiencies, what are the substitute available, but when you fit these history in this chart, it will be very easy. So this is about the 19-year-old patient, having the female residual paralysis around 17 years old, and she walks with a gluteal crutch, means 90 degree contracture of the knee joint and the hip joint. So what are the problems? There is a hip contracture and flexion abduction contracture of 90 and 45 degree. Gluti were significantly weak, but a strong flexor and iliotibial tract were contracted. So what are the substitute for this gluti? Is the iliotibialis and rectus abdominis, and to release the contracture you can do the Campbell's release. But usually Campbell, this balancing of power is usually not required because there is no subluxation or no dislocation. So we release the contracture only. But deformity at the knee joint was 90 degree, quad were 3, and we need a substitute which is semitendinosus and bicep. But this semitendinosus and bicep here is not required because cordyceps power is 3 and she can compensate with this. So balancing power is not required. Then there is a ankle foot deformity. There was no ankle foot deformity. It was controlled knee joint. All the substitute were available, but this is not required. So there is 11 centimeter shortness of this, and she walks with the gluteal crutch and ugly posture of 90 degree hip contractures. So diagnosis here is the postural contracture of the hip joint, flexion 90 degree, 11 degree centimeter shortening, balanced knee, balanced ankle power, and no deformity. So what is demand? Demand is elimination of contracture, so she can have a braceable and normal length limb. So there is a postural stability she requires and the limb lengthening. So what is your decision? Decision in this particular case will be release of the contractures, that is Campbell's release hip joint, Z lengthening and the posterior capsulotomy hip joint, followed by the shoe elevation. And once you do good posture and the balancing path, you need a limb lengthening. So here is the patient. That patient has a 90 degree contracture at the hip joint. There is an abduction flexion contracture at the hip joint as well. So there is a 90 degree contracture and there is a no subluxation, but there is a hypoplasia, significant hypoplasia, pelvic obliquity which is fixed, and there is a contracture at the knee joint where there is no subluxation particularly. So this lady of 19 years operated with the posterior Campbell, because the contracture was over 70 degree. We cannot do 90 degree extension supracondylar osteotomy, but a posterior release of the muscles, and with these shows the nerves which are there, where we have done the all hamstrings release and the posterior capsulotomy, and the same time we have done the Campbell's release at the hip joints. After Campbell's release and the hip joint, there is a significant normal looking limb, and nowadays she walks very easy with the crutches instead of a gluteal crutch. She walks with the raised shoe rod. Now this is about around 1 year old operation, and now we are planning for the limb lengthening, which is universal at the femur and the tibia as well, and inshallah next month we are doing the limb lengthening procedure in this lady. These are the references and acknowledgement. Around 10 literature and books I followed, and taking the pictures and the material for this lecture. This lecture will be available in the slide share tomorrow, and this will also be available in the Club Foot for Facebooks and the YouTube.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhatti. Indeed, this was a very comprehensive lecture, and you've grouped all the reconstruction procedures regarding the lower limb into one place, for which we had to refer to several books. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everyone, participant, expert, and faculty. I am really grateful to you in the month. Thank you very much, sir.